At first glance, molecular cages sound pretty intense, even though separately we know them well. Molecules would make up stuff, and cages, things you make to put children in, I don't know. It's probably the idea that a cage can be made in such a tiny scale that makes it sound so mysterious. Like, how do you even assemble a cage at that tiny scale in the first place?
But before that, let's address the very obvious question, that is, why should I care about molecular cages?
What basically happens in any chemistry lab is that you have something you want to react with another something to come up with a more useful material, maybe for applications in medicine or as the material we need for all kinds of stuff around us, or electronics, building material, packaging, whatever.
Oftentimes, these reactions happen in water, and if you look closely, some parts of material A could get blocked with more of material A,
so it can't react with B. But if we had a way to isolate A with perhaps a cage, then it's easier for A to react with B.
In fact, a specific way of using molecular cages is in medicine.
If we needed a drug to be placed or activated in only a specific part of the body, then we can inject that while it's in a molecular cage and have something like light activate that medicine only where we need it to. Back to assembling cages, as we'd normally have elements like oxygen bond with hydrogen to make water, this time we can think of multiple flat molecules bonding to form this structure. That's pretty much it. We think of bonding, and what we often are introduced to is the picture of one ball interacting with another ball, or multiple balls. But we can actually have one ball interact with balls in the formation of a wall or multiple balls. Sounds legit enough, just change B to W. More importantly, we can make sure these structures form by having our ball molecule bonded with other molecules. So the only spots our wall molecules can bond to are these.
But how can we concretely show that these structures actually form? Obviously, they're too small. No matter what we do, we can't just detect them with our eyes or really any of our senses. Insert the concept of H NMRs, of which I will not explain the name, but it will explain what it does.
Say we have our ball molecule and our wall molecule, which happens to have three regions that have extra electrons. These extra electrons we can use to bond with another species. Note that when they're apart, we get these signals that tell us the electron density around the hydrogens in our molecules, the H in H NMR. Now we can tell these two formed a bond when we see another signal of a different value, preferably one that's higher because it's closer to another source of electrons. So the electron density is supposed to be higher.
Alright, so we know these molecular cages exist. What's the problem?
Well, there are a few limitations, such as how most molecular cages we know how to prepare are positively charged. This would mean we can only trap neutral and negatively charged gas. What do we do if we need to deliver medicine that's positively charged?
Scientists are pretty clever and thought, what about a negatively charged cap for the positively charged cage?
It's so simple because the negative charges on this cap would attract a positively charged guest, as well as the positively charged molecular cage. Once again, we will be using HNMR. Things are pretty direct. We observe signals from different setups. Once with each of them by themselves, once with them paired, and another with all of them. If there's a new signal in the last setup compared to the rest, this indicates that we successfully formed a species with all three of them.
Obviously, we got those signals, otherwise this video wouldn't be here.
Now, there are some unique cases I want to talk about, which ultimately just point to how placing a negatively charged cap is such a game changer with molecular cages.
Wow, that may just have been the nerdiest sentence I've ever said in my life.
So we have three main characters, the cage, the cap, and the guest. Normally, without the cap, our positive cage would only work with a negative guest. But as I said earlier, if we had a negative cap, we can trap a positive guest in our positive cage. Another case includes a hydrophilic guest, or a molecule that would rather be in water instead of inside the cage. But with the inclusion of a negative cap, we were able to trap these hydrophilic guests. Hydrophilic molecules are polar, and that's why they like water, because water is also polar. But because of the negative cap, the positive poles of our hydrophilic molecules bond with these opposite charges. In addition, the negative pole of our hydrophilic molecules also bond with the positive cage.
Everything in this video is just based on a simple fact you've probably known your entire lives, like charges repel and opposites attract.
But that we can creatively apply that to make complex systems like molecular cages even more efficient is so goddamn cool. I hope you enjoyed this video. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.